No notes.
Hello, and welcome back for another episode of the No Notes Show. And as you can see, we have made a couple of changes. So we hope that you like. So we're going to let it do what it do. We're going to jump right into it. We got the executive producer with us, and we're going to start off, as always, with her story. And her story today is about Mariah Carey. And then we're going to talk about some legislation that our president is trying to pass pertaining to cell phone use. And then we're going to get into tonight's topic, which is, ladies, and don't be offended, you know, this is going to be productive, friendly, and educational. How to respect your man. All right, so let's get right into it. What's up, EP? What's going on?
Hey.
What it is?
I'm fine.
How you doing?
I'm pretty good, and you?
Fine. So, Mariah Carey, huh?
We all know Mariah Carey. She needs no introduction.
Oh wow, no introduction.
No intro.
Yeah. Uh huh.
You know, she's a singer, songwriter, producer, and actress. She's won numerous awards, Grammy, you know. We all know that.
Right. So
what you didn't know is she's a philanthropist who has donated time and money to organizations such as the Fresh Air Fund. She became associated with the fund in the early 1990s. And is the co-founder of a camp located in Fishkill, New York, that enables inner-city youth to embrace the arts and introduces them to career opportunities.
Okay, very good.
The camp was called Camp Mariah for her generous support and dedication to Fresh Air children, and she received Congressional Horizon Awards for her youth-related charity work. She is well known nationally for her work in the Make-A-Wish Foundation and granting the wishes of children with life-threatening illnesses. And in November 2006, she was awarded the foundation's Wish Idol for her extraordinary generosity and her many wish-granting achievements.
That's very good. Mm.
Yeah.
So she's really into children's productivity and
right
and how they excel. So that's great.
Carey has volunteered for the New York City Police Athletic League and contributed to the Obstetrics Department of New York Presbyterian Hospital Cornell Medical Center. A percentage of the sales of MTV Unplugged was donated to various other charities. In 2008, Carey was named Hunger Ambassador of the World Hunger Relief Movement. In February 2010, the song 100%, which was originally written and recorded for the film Precious, was used as one of the theme songs for the 2010 Winter Olympics, with all the money proceeds going to the Team USA.
That was a good movie. Very heartfelt.
Yeah.
Wow. So it's interesting how Mariah's involved, and I never knew this. This
I
is all new
that.
To me.
I mean, that aspect.
And it's really kind of sad that that's not more reflected, upon her many accomplishments. I mean, we know her as the singer, but you know, now look what she's involved in. I mean, you know, I never knew.
Yep.
Very, very interesting. And so that's why, you know, and this is why, you know, her story was created within a No Notes show. Because there are so many women out there doing so many things that we don't even know about. And they're in the positions of popularity, positions of power. And it's wonderful to see, you know, what's going on behind the scenes that really should be brought to light, but you know, is not being brought to light. I mean, the focus is on, in most cases, career. So, but, you know, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. So, just, you know, if you want to learn more about Mariah, of course, you know, you always go and research yourself, and maybe you can find out
Wikipedia.
Right, Wikipedia. And maybe you can find out some more things about Mariah and others that we have already talked about in her story that we may not know about, and then you can share it with us. So that's great. So now, this has been a controversial subject and a debate. You know, probably everybody now has a cell phone. Everywhere you go, all the way from adult to children, even older, elderly, you know, everybody is using the cell phone pretty much at this point, this day and time. The problem with that is when we do it when we drive. You know, when you're on the phone, it is a distraction. You know, while you're driving, I mean, and especially if, you know, if you get into a conversation or that is not such a good conversation, it could be negative. And that could take you off of your focus even more. And not only that, you talking on a cell phone, now people are driving and texting on their cell phone, which is, I mean, now you're not even looking at the road. You're down here, you're doing this, you know, and then let somebody say something to you that's out of pocket, and they're all, you know, you're not paying attention, you're mad, you're upset, you're trying to respond, and the next thing you know, something happens. So, President Obama is working on making the no driving, no texting law a federal law, and if that happens, then every state will be required to enforce this law. Currently, not every state is doing this, and that's unfortunate. I mean, because they measure the National Safety Driver Safety Board measures or compares this to the DUI also. I mean, it's as if, you know, using cell phone, you text on your cell phone, is almost to the equivalent of someone that's driving under the influence, because you're really not paying attention. And so we got some information on that the EP is going to share with us, coming from the president, what he's working on.
This is from Newsmax.com. Obama seeks ban on cell phone use on roads. U.S. Transportation Secretary Ray LaHood called on Thursday for a federal law to ban talking on a cell phone or texting while driving any type of vehicle on any road in the country. Tough federal legislation is the only way to deal with what he called a national epidemic. He said at a distracted driving summit in San Antonio, Texas, that drew doctors, advocates, and government officials. That's all I have.
That's all you had. I'd like to make a comment on this topic, and my thinking is, we live in a society where the concept of multitasking is the thing now. It's chic. Mm-hmm. So I guess maybe people are getting it twisted and thinking, well, I'm simply multitasking because I'm on the phone, I'm driving, I'm doing whatever. But in reality, it's like anything, you have to draw a line somewhere. And I think this is where you draw a line with multitasking. Because an accident is a split second. And it's not all about your hands. It's about, you know, the thought, the reaction time, all that's key. You know, you might think, well, you know, I'm just driving and I can text and talk on the phone while I'm driving, but your concentration really needs to be, your focus really need to be on driving. I mean, as simple as it may appear, it's a split second can mean a different thing, life and death.
Right. As of last year, the stats recorded, again from the National Driver Safety Administration, 3,000 deaths were the result of driving and texting. Again, they rate that to the equivalent of a 0.08 alcohol level, which is you're under influence at that point. If you drive, if you went and had some drinks and you're driving and your alcohol level is 0.08, then you're under influence, and that's equal to you doing this while you're driving, trying to look up, trying to drive, looking down, or you're on the phone and you know you're getting upset or whatever the case may be, and then you lose focus on what you're doing. Then next thing you know, you either hit somebody, a pedestrian, or you're hitting another car, or you maybe you're hurting your own stuff, running into a pole or to a tree or anything. So it's very important that we all make an effort to be more careful on our roads. I mean, because what if it's you walking, trying to walk across the street? Or what if you're the other person that's driving and all of a sudden, you know, you're putting that person at risk or multiple parties at risk because you're trying to send a text or trying to look at it, read a text, or you're trying to have a discussion that's upsetting you, or maybe it's not even upsetting you. Maybe it's something else.
Maybe entertaining.
And you're entertaining. You're so entertained by it that's causing you not to pay attention. Mm-hmm. So 32 states currently enforce the law. Today, right now. All 50 states. I hope they pass the law.
So I second that.
You know, everybody be held accountable. And then maybe if you get a ticket, then maybe they'll stop you from doing what you're doing. Because right now, really, I mean, even Pennsylvania is one of the states that enforces the law. New Jersey, Delaware. But even still, people are still, you know, driving and still texting, still, you know. I mean, we have devices out now that you can buy. You know, the hands-free, you could use, little earphones for your phone. Don't play music in there. You know, don't put it on and then you listen and you got it, because that's going to be a distraction too, right in your ears. But there are other things that you can do if you feel the need that you got to be in connection with your phone at all times. There are other things that you can do. And now the new cars that are coming out, they have it built in where you just hit a button. It's part of your navigation system, and then you can talk, you know, it runs through your speaker system. So you're not, you know, there's no need to look down and text, or you know, you're talking, you pay attention to what you're doing, you can drive, and it's hands-free. So, just a word to the wise from the number
of
the show.
How about if you feel as though you need to be on that phone, if that call or text is that important, how about you just pull over?
Right, better yet. That'd probably be your best option.
That's the smartest.
Intense conversation, yeah. Or something that you have to respond to a message and it has some vile text. I mean, there are plenty of medians on the side of the roads, emergency stops, as soon as you can just pull over. I mean, park, and then you can do what you want. You're not moving. You can talk, you can text, do what you want, do everything you need, and then when you're done, resume driving. That's actually the best solution, probably. Beyond hands-free. So, word to the wise, people. You know, just be careful out there. Respect other people, other drivers. Watch out for your pedestrians. Be careful, and then just put the phone down until you can get to that message or get to that phone call. And like the EP just said, if you have to take it right then and there, pull over. Handle your business, and then keep it moving after that. So now we get to the nitty-gritty. And I'm pass it over to my fellow host here. The EP, you got something to share before we get started?
No.
Okay. We're also going to have another guest call in on this subject. Again, this is part of the relationship series. We first started off the relationship series with relationships from a male's perspective. And now we're trying to focus on the female's perspective a little bit. But within that, you know, again, we're not here to offend anybody. The title is Respect Your Man, but we're not talking about a caveman respect. We're not trying to, like, serve your man like something that goes on in a restaurant. You know, we're talking about genuine respect, just like females expect to be respected. I mean, males deserve that same respect. So that's what we want to talk about. And my colleague Doc over here is going to start us off on that. So what's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, my thoughts on that is I personally would like to see men, male and female, try to find that happy medium in their relationship. I think it's significant that you really listen to your man and try to where possible accommodate him. And not necessarily look upon him as an infant or infantile or someone that's immature or a little boy. I think those type of things are very derogatory. I think they add nothing positive to the relationship. It doesn't make you any larger in your image or as a person. I think that the solution is really to be honest and to respect one another. And I think in respecting one another, you listen to what each other is saying and take it seriously and try to see if you can find that happy medium or if you can accommodate each other. And I think it was T.D. Jakes had a movie out, Not Easily Broken. And in that movie, they had a scene I thought was very appropriate. Although he was dealing with a marriage, it still could apply to a committed relationship. And that theory was, or the concept was, there should be three strands in a relationship, he said, in a marriage. It should be the man, the woman, and God. No one else, no girlfriends, no boyfriends, no mothers, no fathers, no sisters, no brother. Those three strands, and you'll have a strong relationship, and you'll have, I think, a more harmonious relationship. Because this thing about you going to a friend and asking them questions about whatever, when you talk to that person, you're giving that person your spin or your perception of how you see it. So 9 out of 10 times, they're going to see it the way you see it. That's not really solving your problem. Solving the problem is sitting down with your mate and finding out what it is that each other and how each other see certain things and working through that, the two of you. Mm-hmm. Because again, talking to the third party, you don't know, they may have a hidden agenda. Maybe they may not be that crazy about you or your mate. Maybe they had they get a bad vibe from your mate. So you don't know what their agenda is to go to somebody and ask them a question about, well, we're doing this or we're thinking about that, what do you think? It shouldn't be about what they think. It should be about what your mate and you think. That's my spin.
And again, the reason why we're calling this episode or this topic Respect Your Man, again, we're not talking about going back and, you know, old school, real old school, and like, you know, you gotta weigh on your man hand and foot, the woman doesn't work, or the woman should stay home. That's absolutely not where we're going with this. Where we're going with this is a man's nature, a man's character, a man is proud. A man has an ego. And again, let me speak on that a little bit. Not to feed 100% into a man's ego, I mean, because that can spill for disaster too. But you know, you gotta keep that in mind. I mean, pride, ego, you know, the man in the relationship position, if it's a good man, a decent man, he wants to take care of the woman. He wants to take care of the family, be the provider. But also, the man should also be equal, but as well as the woman. So, you know, nobody's perfect. You know, we're human. We're man, woman. We're human. We're going to make mistakes. It should not be the woman's position to try to belittle the man, to make him feel small or inferior, or you know, you're just a waste. Yeah, I mean, you're weak. You know, I mean, that is absolutely the wrong twist. I mean, you're gonna have problems in relationships, or even if it's not a relationship, even if it's just maybe a man and a woman got involved, they have a child or children together, then maybe they're not together. It still needs to be that respect. He is the children's father. You know, he is a man. He is a person. I mean, those things matter. I mean, just like you want to be respected, it should not be so easy to come off on a man and just try to rip apart the man's character as you see fit, and then you feel like you're justified in doing that, and then nothing's supposed to happen. Now, again, I think it's safe to say for us, you know, myself, Doc, we're real men. You know, it's not a man, I mean, no matter what, a man, I'm going to just go into the physical part of it. No way, shape, or form ever should a man hit a woman. I don't care what the woman does or what the woman says or how it's belittled. I mean, it should never get to that level. And that's not something that we condone. We don't do it. We don't hit our wives, our women. We wouldn't condone another man taking that action. But at the same time, it does get to oh so much a person can take before, you know, that man can snap. And that's wrong. I mean, but looking at it from the woman's side, I mean, the woman needs to understand too that, you know, it shouldn't get to that level either.
Well, see, that's a key point that you brought up, because that's a very valid point what you said. But also, again, in a relationship, it shouldn't be a double standard. And I say that because if you notice, and this is a human thing, it's not necessarily a man thing. The first thing a woman does when she gets frustrated or she gets angry or upset, whatever term you want to use, she reaches out and she'll slap. She'll slap.
Right.
He made me so mad. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, why would you try to slap a man that you know you can't physically challenge?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But to think that, okay, well, you're a man, you shouldn't hit me, that's true. And like you said, mm-hmm. we don't hit women. But mm-hmm. my point is, you shouldn't provoke anybody. You shouldn't say, mm-hmm. well, I'm a woman. When I slap you, it doesn't hurt. Yes, mm-hmm. it does hurt. It does hurt a man. It has a certain detrimental thing about mm-hmm. it. You know, so my point is, again, you shouldn't hit. You don't want to be hit. You shouldn't be hit.
Right. Yeah, that's true. I mean, because it does go to that point of oh so much what one can take.
And the other thing
is always a breaking point for somebody.
It is. Mm-hmm. And I was going to say, sometimes men try to walk away from situations. Right. If a man tries to walk away from the situation, let him walk.
Right.
Don't jump in front of the door and say, where are you going? And right. I'm not finished. I want to talk. You know, at that point, he's talked out.
Right.
And he's at a point now where it could get physical.
Right.
Let him walk.
Right.
You know, let him walk.
Right.
And another point I like to point out is also, if a man ever hit you the first time, I would recommend that you really seriously think about leaving. I don't care what kind of flowers he buys, how much he apologizes, regardless of how humble he humbled himself. The first time is always the most difficult time. The second time is going to be easier. Third time is easier. And the next time, fourth time, when you look at him cross-eyed, he's going to slap you. So my point, women always make, a mistake. Man slap her or hit her, whatever case may be. Oh, he didn't mean it. He was sorry. That was my fault. No. If a man hits you, it's time for you to pack up and leave, and don't come back.
EP, what do you think? What's your opinion on it? From the woman's point of view. From a
female's perspective.
Right.
Lost audio.
We lost audio. Can you hear us?
What I have to say is, always think about, would you rather be treated? Would you want to be treated that way?
Exactly.
True.
Can you hear?
Yeah, we got you.
Okay. Before you do or say something, would you want somebody to do or say that to you? treat others as though you would want them to treat you.
And that comes from the Bible. That's what, I mean, you know, that's what God says. Treat others as you would want to be treated. I mean, here's an example. I think this is a good example. And this is on looking at it from a woman's point of view. Attractive woman or women walking down the street, up and down the street, whatever. You know, guys are out, you know, say in this instance, a few guys are hanging out on the corner. The woman's walking past, or women walking past, and the guys are going, you know, they're not being respectful. You know, they're calling out to them, whistling, hey, baby, this and that, you know, da-da. You know, come here, and they, you know. That, to us, I think that's, I mean, if you want to approach somebody, first of all, their name's not hey, their name's not baby, they're not some other name. You don't even know them yet. So why are you referring to them, you know, in a sense, out of pocket? I mean, if you want to approach somebody, you should go up, I mean, be a gentleman, say hello, or excuse me, man, or however you want to do it. Can I speak to you for a minute? I mean, you know, but what happens is, in a lot of cases, because, and probably because the way a woman is being addressed in that type of situation, you know, the woman doesn't stop. The woman may say something smart or whatever, or, you know, she might look, you know, give that look. And then the next thing you know, now that from the guy's side, oh, bitch, go ahead. I mean, you know, now she all kinds of names. I mean, we, you know, how you feel in that moment right there, as a woman, you don't like that. You feel like it's totally disrespectful, you know, y'all, like, you know, because I didn't speak to you or I didn't say something back to you, now I'm all kinds of names. That's the same way a man can feel when a woman is trying to beat them over the head with their words, you know, calling them out of pocket, going to the girlfriends, talking to them about the girlfriends, and the girlfriends know the whole business, the whole situation, which they really shouldn't know. Now you got girlfriends may come around. And then say it's a marriage. Let's talk about marriage for a minute. The wife goes out, you know, the wife and the husband may have an argument. The wife goes out, she got a bunch of friends, she hang out with the girls. Oh, guess what, my man, you know. Then all of a sudden, say, you know, these same girlfriends frequent your home. You know, they're in and out your house, they come, and then all of a sudden they feel comfortable as to say, mention something, you know, they'll just come out with it towards the husband. That's disrespectful. You know, I mean, you can't, this is still this man's home. You can't come in here, you know, you already know, first of all, you know about things you shouldn't know about, and then you're gonna come in my house and you're gonna try to say something to me. You know, and then don't expect a consequence behind that or get kicked out of the house. I mean, men don't need that. I mean, that's what hurts them. I mean, and really, you know, the reaction, yeah, is an argument and everything. It's everybody's upset, is hollering and screaming. I mean, but going back to the pride thing, you're hurting that man's pride, you're disrespecting him in his house. I mean, you know, come on. That same way you felt like when you was walking down that street is the same way when a woman comes at a man like that. I mean, again, going back to the human factor, everybody makes mistakes. Things are going to happen in relationships. Relationships are not perfect, and they shouldn't be. You know, you need to argue every now and then. I mean, if you don't argue, something's wrong with that. If you don't have an occasional argument, I mean, something. What's up?
You made an interesting point, because then too, you have to stop and realize there is no real standard,
right,
per se, because, you know, you have different elements in every gender or every race. And I'm saying that to say that, like you were saying earlier, you know, guys say, hey, baby, and speak to a woman out of her name. Well, the reason why he does that is because he's had success with it.
Right.
So there's that element or that group of females that respond to that.
Right.
you know, that derogatory, right. you know, disrespect type thing. And some females will respond to that.
Right.
And that's what he's accustomed to. Mm-hmm. He's been successful with that. But going back to what you were saying before about the argument, there are some people, I'm convinced that they need drama in their life.
yeah.
So, I mean, if it's calm yeah. and peaceful, they're uneasy.
Right.
You know,
right,
so,
yeah.
you know
yeah, yeah.
is that fine, that happy meeting? But I think if you sit down and talk to each other and really listen to each other and put that third and fourth element out of the conversation and not this thing where you're trying, whatever a strong woman is, whatever the case may be, if it means that you contradict your man, I think it's about respecting each other and trusting one another
right.
and not deceiving each other. I mean, if you're saying, for instance, that if you're not pleasing me sexually, oh, well, I didn't want to tell him he wasn't pleasing me because I might
offend him.
Offend right. his fragile right. ego. Well, we all have egos. Right. Women have egos, men have egos. And I think a man would appreciate that more. It's about timing. You find the right moment and sit down and have a nice conversation, nice moment, whatever. Then you introduce that into the conversation, you know, by the way, blah, 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 blah. You know, as a woman, when you want to get a point across, how you get that point across in a civil manner.
Right.
You don't have to be obnoxious. You don't have to be offensive. No one wants to hear anything offensive, regardless of male or female, because you don't get a derogatory answer back.
Right.
So, again, if you're really trying to do something constructive, and you're having problems in the bedroom, you know, then you approach that in a civil, mature manner. And it's not about egos. A man has no problem hearing about his deficiencies if it's presented in a civil, mature way.
Right.
So this thing about, oh, his fragile ego. No, man doesn't have a fragile ego no more than a woman has a fragile ego about not wanting to hear her faults. You know, we tell a woman about her faults. Oh, why you have to say it like that? Oh, this, you know, we all have egos. So if you're truly trying to make your relationship work, be constructive and be adult about it. A man is an adult. A man does not want to be nurtured as a little boy.
Mm-hmm.
He's a grown man.
Mm-hmm.
And once you realize that and respect him as such, and he should respect you as a female.
Right. So, EP, I think you lined up a caller for us.
Yes.
So I guess we can pause for a minute, and so all we
right.
can get our caller in and get her to join us on this topic for a couple of minutes.
All right.
And then we'll get
she
back
has
to
a
you.
Question that she wants to discuss with you guys also.
Okay. All right.
All right.
We'll be here.
All right.
All right. While we wait for that phone call, let's talk a little sports. Hot topic, Deion Sanders, as we all know now, is in the public eye that him and his wife are currently in the process of starting divorce proceedings. Couple issues with that, though. Deion spoke out yesterday, and in his defense, well, actually, we're getting a call right now. Let's answer that. Hello, caller.
Hey, this is Shirley.
Hey,
we'll get back to Deion in a minute.
Yeah,
hey, how you doing?
I'm doing fine.
All right.
You look well.
We looking spiffy.
Yeah, I'm trying to. You know what I mean? Just trying to. Now, okay.
Oh, you shouldn't be so modest.
I'm letting you know. I like the way you guys have it hooked up with J-Rod. That's beautiful.
Oh, okay, yeah. yeah. We can't do it without the EP.
Hey.
J-Rod, you can't do it without her.
Okay. I got a question I want to ask you guys.
Okay.
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 Uncle White, okay. What is the difference between public school and charter school? What is the difference?
Well... From my understanding of it is, and I have minimal knowledge, but from the basics of a charter school is, it's supposed to be a means of a better education as opposed to public. It's smaller, classroom size is smaller. They supposed to provide more, to say that the Philadelphia public school system doesn't have good teachers, but I guess a more stronger foundation of a teaching system. And a smaller school altogether. You know, they're not as large as the regular public school. And academically, for the children, it's better academically. A charter school is better. Because also, some charter schools are, from my understanding, a little more difficult to get in as opposed to your regular school. But it's more focused on, the charter school is more focused on children, you know, academically, socially too. And that's important because, you know, in the class, for example, say in your, let's say average in the public school class size, maybe 25 to 30 children. And in the charter school, it could be 18 children or 15 to 18. So the teacher is able to spend more time individually with each child. You know, the focus is greater. And I think it's a level of respect too. I mean, in terms of socialization with the children too, with each other and with the faculty. So that's my understanding of it from what I've heard.
Well, this is more of a question than a statement. Does charter school, are they doing anything special with parent-teacher relationship?
Well, I think it's structured. I think with the charter schools, it's a better structure.
Okay.
Across the board. I mean, in the classroom, with the parents, the communication, it's smaller, it's better controlled, and more focused. That's what I get. That's what I've heard from people that have children in charter schools. And then charter schooling is on the rise. And just also to add with that, now they got cyber school. So, which is, to me, I mean, we all heard about homeschool. I mean, parents keep their children at home and they meet the state standard, but they teach their children at home. I mean, I think that's a great thing, but I think the issue with that is, where's the social part of that? I mean, you know, your child or your children are not able to interact with other children.
Exactly.
And I think that's not a thought, that's a fact. I mean, that's part of a child's development.
Exactly.
To be able to socialize and interact with their peers.
Exactly.
And I think with homeschool, that's missed. Now, with cyber school, is a little different. And which we just recently learned a little bit about cyber school. I mean, it's like a virtual school. It's computerized, but it's children with their peers still, but in a very, very small. I mean, it's minimal, and it's not a school though. I mean, this, you can have a cyber school in a daycare center, for example. That's small on a small level.
Intimate, yeah.
But they're still interacting with other children. You know, they're still getting the academics that they need. I mean, and they're getting both pieces, as opposed to if you're just home. Now, I'm not saying that it doesn't work. I mean, it's just the appearance of it. I mean, maybe there is a piece where, parents that do homeschool, they make it so that the social part of it is added. I don't know how that's done. I mean, I'm not going to sit here and speak on it. That I have facts about it. I mean, it's maybe if there is something that we're missing or it's different ways that it's done. But yeah. I just think overall, how do you do it? I guess the question is how do you do it?
How do you emulate that?
Right. How do you emulate the social piece?
Yeah.
So I mean that. But going back to charter school, I mean that's our definition of it of what you know.
What about funding?
Right, and then right now, I mean, if you look at it, you've been following the news, the Philadelphia school district is in a crisis.
Hmm.
I mean, they're talking, and I don't fault Mayor Nutter. I mean, I really think he's trying to do the best he can do with the situation.
It's politics.
I mean, you know, but it's tough. I mean, they're talking about closing, I believe, 46 schools. Is that right? 42 schools or 46 schools over the next 5 years. They don't have the money.
But you know what?
Yeah, I mean, it's just, I mean, and then that, what does that mean? You're losing teachers. I mean, where are the, I mean, when once you close these schools, where are these kids going?
You know what?
I mean, you know, it's all these questions. I mean, but in order to control the deficit, the deficit is so deep. What else are you going to do?
It's more about politics because, you know, and I hate to call it Republican-Democrat nonsense, but the reality is that Republicans it's some kind of assault going on education. And they're doing everything possible to make education almost an elite kind of situation. You know, my thinking is that it shouldn't be about politics. It shouldn't be about, like you're talking about Nutter in the city. Mm. It's because in most states where you have a Republican governor, these are the kind of problems that you're having, more magnified. Mm. I've always felt as though the solution to the problem, I'm not knocking charter schools, the solution to the problem would be it should be mandatory that public officials, kids must go to public schools. If that was the case, you see a different public school system. Okay.
Right. I agree.
Their kids
that.
Are going to private school. They could care less about a public school. So right. They'll cut funds.
Right.
You know, it should be mandatory. It's like the mandatory, you work in a city, you know, you have to live in the city. It should be mandatory. If you're any kind of public official, mayor, senator, governor, whatever the case may be, your kids must go to a public school.
Everybody.
And you will see a different public school system than you see today.
And just to add to that, the crisis, the Philadelphia school district crisis, that's also, I just feel, contributed to the former superintendent.
Oh, well, okay.
I mean, she really, what can you say? She put her hammer down and she walked away. She walked
she
away
got
pretty,
paid.
Pretty fat. I mean, you know, hey. You know, you can't be mad at that.
Wait a minute. Do you think a charter school that it's still being run like a private school, a parochial school, you think that in order to get into the charter school, you got to have some money or something?
No, not. I mean, there's a criteria that you
okay.
meet. I don't know. I mean, it could be some type of funding involved, or maybe not. Maybe it's based on, because I mean, if you look at the locations of some of these charter schools, I mean, they're in locations that you would not think they would be. Like one charter school that I'm aware of is on the corner of Broad and South. That's one.
Wow.
I mean, really? You know, so I mean, it's not, you know, I mean, you do have them in neighborhoods, but I mean, you know, but then it's just, you know, it's like there, it's a strategy to place it.
Okay.
You know, to make a building a charter, you know, create it, turn it into a charter school, and then
yeah.
So I just found that to be interesting. How you know, how do they choose their location?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if that part of the makeup or the basis of a charter school where it's located or what, but. There's definitely a criteria involved. You're not just going like public
school. It's a method to the madness.
Yeah, right. You're not living in the neighborhood and you're just going. It's different. So
I have a girlfriend and her son. I know he was in public school for a while, and then when he graduated from the junior high school or something, I'm not even sure which grade it was.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he was doing pretty good in public school, but there might have been a little problem going on. So his last 3 years, his last 4 years, he had Excel, okay, whereby, you know, when you get marks on your report card, you know, they can't give you 100.
Mm-hmm.
In math, I'll put it this way, he's graduating, I guess, in May or June or something like that, and he got a full scholarship. Go to college as an engineer.
Well, that's wonderful.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's wonderful. Full scholarship.
Yeah, that's commendable.
Yeah, I definitely think in terms of the level of education, especially now, all that's going on with Philadelphia and their system, you're probably most likely getting a better education in charter school. I mean, that's unfortunate to say. I mean, because the school system in Philadelphia is just so chaotic right now. It's just ripped apart. I mean, teachers are angry, and they have every right to be. I mean, what's been done to them is wrong. I mean, they've been shortchanged. They're not respected. They got to go in. They got to deal with disrespectful kids. I mean, that's right there. That's enough right there. But, I mean, to have your management just rip you apart, too, at the same time, it's just... But and then now you got the mayor has to come in, and now just like a chopping block. Just okay, well, and then you know it's not over. I mean, this is just like it started with the superintendent. Now it's just like a domino effect. It's just rolling downhill. Now, I mean, teachers. I mean, not only teachers are going to lose their jobs. Programming is going to be terminated. Music programs, athletic programs. I mean, right. You know, those extracurricular activities, you're going to lose right. all that. And then again, going back to the other question, once you chop a school, where are they going? Is that part of the plan? Are they going to be able to transition to a charter school? I mean, how's that going to work? Right now, it's just talking about, I mean, the focus is, and here we go, we always get back to the green, it's all about the money. So right now the major focus is how to cut the debt. I mean, I think and so you think about, I mean, your priority is cutting the debt, yes, but I mean, are you thinking about what the long-term effects are? I mean, cuz ultimately it should be about the children. I mean,
well, see, that makes
sense. But I think that's being, of course, that here we are, another situation that's going to be missed.
That leads me to the belief that when something like this happens, that means there's a master plan in place.
He called it a master plan. This is not
just haphazardly happening. If they're doing this to public schools, they're trying to channel these kids somewhere else.
Yeah.
They're not just going to leave them back. You know. So maybe they're trying to channel these kids to charter schools. Something, because they were a voucher program out one time that politicians have been trying to fight, you know, for these vouchers. I'm not sure if that would affect charter schools. I think it had something to do with private schools as well. I think some people gripe was that why should we pay for private schools or something? But it's all this to me is saying that someone has a plan where they're trying to channel something somewhere, either charter schools or private schools.
Right.
You know, it's not just when they attack something like that. It's not just blindly doing something.
Right.
It's a purpose in place, and we will never know.
Well, I tell you what. We'll definitely look into it, and we'll raise this question again further down the line in another episode, because it is an interesting topic. And now that you brought it up, I'd like to know more myself.
Yeah.
You know what I'm gonna do? One day I'm gonna get in contact with my girlfriend, and you know, get real deep into it.
That'd be great. You can bring it to us. You can let us know what the real deal is behind the charter school.
Is she a teacher?
No. Okay. We all work together, but somehow or another that you want to put her son in. And it looked like there was a little problem, I think, disciplinary.
Okay.
Down with the school, she was having a little problem with it, but soon as she moved him out of the public school and got him in charter school, that's all he did was that's all he did.
Turned into a success story. So that's great. That's awesome.
So I'm thinking maybe
the
charter school, that there's like you said, a different criteria. And the fact that you're not going to come in here and do what you want to do.
Public school. Right, right.
Because if you don't act right here and buckle down here, you out the door.
Right.
I'm getting that impression. You know what I mean?
Right.
But you know what, too, Shirley? I've noticed in past experience that when a child is gifted,
that might be it.
And they're not challenged, Then they wander. Oh, they start getting into trouble. They start playing. They start doing things because you're not really challenging that child.
Right.
Or you take a child and sort of teach him where, you know, like he's insignificant in life, you know, then he tends to drift and start doing crazy things.
Right.
A lot of times, you know, these kids are very, very, you know, intelligent, very gifted kids, but sometimes the system doesn't reach everybody.
Right.
You know.
So just real quick, got a question for you. Well, how do you feel about the term "respect your man"? What thoughts come to your mind about that? And we're not talking about, before you answer, we're not talking about caveman respect. We're not talking about serve your man like you serve, like somebody gets served in a restaurant. We're talking about a genuine respect for a man in your life, or a man that you know, or, you know. And of course, all respect to your husband that's gone now, Blue.
Yeah.
But I mean, I'm sure you. I mean, you know, you. But you had a very long, successful marriage. I must say, 42 years is wonderful. But I mean, in terms of respect your man, what do you think? What do you think entails that?
What aspect?
Yeah.
Well, okay. I knew I shouldn't have called in there.
I mean, in one sentence. Go ahead.
Respecting him. You respect your husband. Mm-hmm. Your husband respect you.
Right.
Everybody has their own opinion, and there's a way of dealing with it, handling it, sitting down, talking about it. It's two-sided. You get respect.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's, there you go. In a nutshell, that's it. True. That's it. Bottom line.
That's very true.
Oh, I did it right.
Yeah.
It was short and sweet.
Short and sweet. Right to the point.
Okay. Yeah. You got to earn it, but then it's a way of going about doing it and bringing it to the table, as you say.
Right.
Him and her.
Right. Well, see, that's the key.
Let's sit down and like talk about it and say, okay, we all have, you know, our own ideas and whatnot. Let's see if we can work this out a normal way.
But you said the key.
You're thinking, and you know, all the time, and mm-hmm. I'm right where I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. Let's see if we can pull all this stuff.
Find a happy medium.
Right, right.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But you see, and that can be accomplished if you keep them third and fourth parties out of it.
Right.
See, and that's where I think the problem comes in. When you go outside and start talking to other people, if you sit down with your mate and you two are trying to find that happy medium between the two of you, not your mother, your sister, your brother, the two of you trying to find a happy medium, because what works for you two may not work for somebody else.
True. Mm-hmm.
So that's true. Where it's key. So that's why you can't go outside asking 1,001 people, because you make things more complicated because you're trying to please 1,000 people. You just please each other.
I guess the reason why people do things like that, to vent, you know, they just kind of vent. And I, like you said, sometimes you can go vent, both sides, and the outside people already got the story. They don't know that you came back into the home and you just straightened that out.
Yeah, see, that's the key.
And that's still everything that you be venting about and he be venting about. That's still on their mind. And somehow no, that ain't gonna go away. And then you're wondering why, you know, like I said, they're coming in trying to tell you, we can straighten that problem out. You know, that's water under the bridge. I guess you have to bend or either go out there in the forest and scream or something, you know, make a sound. At least you can be able to hear it when the tree falls. You understand what I'm talking about?
But when you vent, maybe you need to tell them that, look, I'm just venting right now. This doesn't give you freedom to voice your opinion going forward if I don't ask for it.
Right.
But some people assume that when you vent like that, they automatically take that as, okay, this is open season now. Whenever you don't have to ask them anymore after that. Anytime you look bad or, what's wrong? He doing this again? You know, they feel as though they have a right now to get into your business, and they don't.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know?
So bottom line is, you know, when it comes to it, yes, respect your man, but ultimately respect each other, men and women.
That's right.
That's the message.
And trust each other.
Right.
And keep everybody out your business. Mm-hmm.
Right.
So real quick, getting back to okay, okay, great.
I really can't see you guys, it's
a work in progress.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm gonna try to get back and find something else to hit y'all with.
Okay? Oh yeah, well if you like I said, if you go into get into contact with your girlfriend about the charter school situation.
Okay. Yeah, follow up on that.
Follow up on it and then bring it back to us. That'd be great.
Okay, I'm gonna write that down, but you're not being forgot as soon as I write that off.
Okay, right.
Hey, I have those moments too.
Well, this is all the time. So I have little
Hey, better safe than sorry.
Right, okay. All right, thank you guys.
All right,
talk to you. Have a nice evening.
All right.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right, that was Shirley. Mm. All right, so now getting back to Dion, then we'll sum things up with Sports Talk with No Notes. Dion spoke out yesterday. Apparently, his wife or his ex-wife-to-be has been going around talking to the media, of course, saying that Dion has allegedly, and that's how we'll put it, hit her. Dion spoke out yesterday. He said this is absolutely not true. She's, of course, which is natural. I mean, a natural reaction. She's very upset. She doesn't understand or whatever. I mean, this is the part where, we always say on our show that really, it's between the parties involved. It shouldn't be a public thing. It shouldn't be out there like that. I mean, it's between them two. Whatever, for whatever reasons, they're separating or it's not working or whatever. And it has to end this way. That is very unfortunate that a marriage, here's another marriage that's going to end. I mean, but ultimately, you going out. And the reason why, what's being said now, is the reason why she's going out. Because she feels like that Dion, the public figure, a former football player, a successful football player, he also is involved with children.
On TV.
Very much so. He has a school. He's very dedicated to that. I mean, he's doing some great things with children and education and some other things going on. And she feels like she can't compete with his image. So I guess this is her answer to trying to, if she can't compete with it, then try to, here we go, admonish him or make him look bad, destroy his character. So that's the way she's kind of, staring this way. And that's it is emotion. It's emotions involved. I mean, she's upset. She's hurt. But again, I'm sure Dion is hurt too. I mean, I'm sure. I mean, who wants, bottom line, and this is our opinion, who wants a marriage to end? We don't think people get married a few years later, we're going to get a divorce. I mean, I don't think that's in the plan. Mm-hmm. I mean, again, unfortunate. This is unfortunate. So Dion wants to tell his side of the story and says, when this supposedly or allegedly happened again, the boys were home, their sons were home, children were home, the witnesses, they're witnesses to the account. Nothing happened. But of course, when you hear about something like this, the first thing, oh yeah, he did it. Oh yeah, he's beating her. Yeah, all these things. But really, again, it's not our business. I mean, these are two people. Let them go through what they need to go through. I mean, it's bad enough. Children are involved. I mean, it's got to be affecting them very deeply that their parents are separating why add more to that? I mean, it's unfortunate that she's doing what she's doing. I mean, I hope it's not true. I mean, but again, we don't know. Basically the interview yesterday was that's what it's about. We just hope that, this is always a bad outcome. I mean, again, a marriage has ended. So I guess, for the sake of the children or however you can do it, hopefully the outcome will be a positive one in the end. And, both parties can move on and they can still stay in contact and raise their two boys together and be a part of their lives and have a civil relationship. Hopefully that will be the outcome. But right now, it's starting to get ugly. unfortunately. So I don't know if she's trying to seek charges against Deion. I did not get that part. You know, I didn't hear that yet, but maybe that's coming. And so hopefully her allegations or her statements are just out or just that. So another, speaking in other failed marriages, Martin Lawrence and his wife are getting a divorce after 15 years. But I just mentioned this because Martin also interviewed, but his outlook on it was very different from what Deion is currently going through. Apparently, they have an understanding already. They had a conversation, him and his ex-wife would be, and Martin's statement was they will remain friends and will be able to continue to raise their children, and it will be a productive relationship. They just won't be together. And again, that's unfortunate. I mean, 15 years is a long time. But at least it's civil. Right now, it appears that it's civil. But, you know, we'll see. I mean, you know, like you said earlier, you know, people like to be surrounded by drama.
They doing that. They're taking a page out of the criminal courtroom the court of public opinion.
Right.
Putting everything out, you know. But it seems like you can see that's part of the problem right there. It's like, obviously, they haven't been talking to each other in the past, you know. And, like, the way she said she found out about the divorce.
Well, yeah. Through Twitter.
Through Twitter. And he went on Twitter and said the same thing.
Right. They had a conversation and everything. Yeah. You know, everything's everything. But this is what, unfortunately, is going to happen.
We decided.
So maybe that's some untruth to that. But, I mean, we wish them both well. We hope it works out for the best, ultimately, for their children.
The court of public opinion.
Right, and kind of, as much as you can, keep our friends, the paparazzi, the media, out of it.
Now, one point I wanted to address about the assault thing. Mm-hmm. My impression was that he was accused of assaulting her.
Right.
And I think he accused her and her friend of assaulting him.
Oh. Interesting.
I think they both had
So don't let it get like that. I mean,
he said he would never hit a woman.
Yeah, he did say that. Plus
the kids were there.
Right.
But they made it sound like she, I think it was a female friend, attacked him. Now, I don't know who's telling the truth.
Well,
somewhere in there is the truth.
Well, you know how it is. You know, the truth always comes out in the end. So hopefully, it's just allegations, and that's where it will stay. But again, we wish for the outcome, for the sake of your children, we wish it to be a positive outcome. In other news, Sixers did win game two.
In big fashion.
So, against Chicago. So, again, we're in round one of the playoffs. So, hopefully that momentum is back from that starting in the beginning of the season, of the regular season. Maybe that momentum is now back in the playoffs. So, hopefully they can continue that and then maybe get to the second round. So, but we'll see. When's the next game?
Friday.
So we'll see Friday what's happening.
But see, I have a concern about the Sixers. The way they played the other night, game two, they showed those flashes during the course of the season. Mm. It seemed like for some reason they can't seem to bottle that, you know, and do it on a consistent basis.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can't wait till Friday come to see. You know, like someone was saying, oh, they played great defense. Now they know defense. When they've played great defense during the course of the season, they have the same results.
Right.
But they can't seem to capture that all the time.
Yeah.
And that's going to be the key.
So they got a hold. They caught it in game two. They got to hold on to it. Mm-hmm. Flyers. Flyers lost game two against the Devils. So hopefully... you know, it was scary with round one against Pittsburgh. So I mean, but we pulled it out in round one. So round two, the Devils. Hopefully we can defeat the Devils and continue on the road to the Stanley Cup. So we'll see. We'll keep close eye on that as well. See what transpires with the next game.
There seems to be some sort of concern with the Flyers in the next game. something to do with the ice being slushy or...
Let's not make excuses.
This is not... They're saying, that's the word on the street. That something they're having some sort of problem with the ice where they're playing in the next game.
Okay.
It's, they use the term thing slush or whatever.
Okay.
But it's not slush to the point where they won't play the game.
Oh.
But...
Oh, but what it might affect the game.
Look, it sounds like a conspiracy theory in that the condition of the ice would be detrimental to the Flyers and advantageous to the who they play in the winter.
Oh, come on. Don't. So, what do we say? Don't, as our infamous behind-the-scenes partner says, don't believe the hype.
Don't believe the hype.
Shout out to James Ward. Shout out to James Parker. JP.
Keeping it real.
So that ends our show for this episode. As always, you know, please continue to watch our current and new episodes as they come out. Check us out on Facebook. We have our own page, a group page, and a main page on Facebook. Check out both. Become a member of our crew page and stay in contact with us. Share your comments, suggestions, and feedback. We look forward to hearing from you in terms of what can make our show better. You can also send us an email, thenonoshow@aol.com. Leave your comments and feedback and suggestions there as well. We also are on YouTube. Just go to YouTube, type in The No Notes Show. That'll take you to our channel. And there, you'll be able to access all our episodes and, again, leave your comments, feedback, suggestions. As always, please continue your support. We appreciate your support. We love everyone that has been responding to us on Facebook. We hope that you spread the word to others and continue to show the love as we continue to try to grow. Until next time, you know what it is. Missing No Notes is a
uh-uh.
Until next time, peace.
Well, did you get our...